Good morning and welcome to the 50th episode of the Stahls TV Morning Show. I'm Courtney K.
I'm Courtney.
And I'm not. This is going to be a good episode. It's a special edition episode. So it's going to be a little longer length than a typical episode. So we'll give you that up front. So if you have something that you need to move to, it will be recorded as always and posted on the stallstv.com website. I'm Josh, by the way. And we've been with you now for 49 episodes. This is our big number 50.
Right, and the reason that we wanted to bring this special episode to you guys is because our premiere episode aired June 8th, and our first episode aired on June 22nd. So this is our one-year anniversary / 50th episode. It's just really exciting to be here still.
Yeah, and we're excited to have you here. You've been behind the scenes for this a lot of the run. You started showing up in front of the camera recently, but for those of you that don't know, Courtney S. Has helped us to produce all of this content since our very first pilot episode and really helped to keep us organized through this journey with ideas and content.
It's a big task.
Yeah.
It's been fun, definitely.
Yeah, and so today we came up with the concept that we want to share 50 ideas. 50 tips, really, that will help you grow your business. And so throughout the course of the episode, we'll be looking back at some of our favorite moments throughout Stahls TV Morning Shows and some of our moments that aren't so favorite. But either way you look at it, we're going to have a lot of fun today. And as always, this is live. If you have questions, please chat them in. We'll stop at several times throughout today's presentation to answer them. So let's look back to our very first pilot episode so we can frame the concept of what the Stahls TV Morning Show is designed for.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the Stahls TV Morning Show. I'm Zach Ellsworth.
And I'm Josh Ellsworth, and we'll be your hosts on the Stahls TV Morning Show, giving you buzz, news, and know-how at the frequency your business needs it.
Go ahead.
The Stahls TV Morning
Show. I interrupted him already.
Yeah, it's all right. It's our first time. The Stahls TV Morning Show is designed to really help you grow in your business. So it's ideas and taking a look at successful businesses, what they're doing right, which was the point of the poll question that we started things off with on whether or not you've heard of Teespring before.
Yeah, we'll talk about that more in a minute. Want to tell you a little bit about how often we'll be coming to you here. This is our pilot episode. We want to thank you for logging in and watching. We will be coming to you live every Monday morning beginning June 22nd at 11 a.m. Eastern time. So you can plan to sign up and watch us then.
Excellent. And you can go to stallstv.com, click on the events tab, and the June 22nd episode is there waiting for you to sign up. After this episode concludes, of course. So to kick things off on the Stahls TV Morning Show, we're kind of working through the format, you know, as we go through. But one of the things we definitely want to share is success stories of businesses that are doing well.
We've certainly shared a lot of ideas and content since that first pilot episode. We've shared some industry trends, some businesses that are doing well, and just new ways to grow business. And that's, of course, what we're always looking to do here at the Morning Show. And the first tip that we have for our 50 tips really leads in well to that. It's subscribe to industry magazines. So if you aren't currently subscribed to things like Impressions Magazine, Printware, Team and Spirit, we showcase those a lot on the Morning Show and pull out different articles, but they do similar things to what we do at the Morning Show. We help just to keep you up on new ideas and ways to grow your business all throughout different types of technology in the industry.
Yeah, absolutely. So tip number one, subscribe to industry magazines. Number two is build a relationship with your sales rep at each vendor. And so the industry magazines are going to keep you plugged into a lot of what's happening, how-to info. Building a relationship with your sales rep at your vendor is also going to do the same thing sort of within the industry, because one of the key things that we'll emphasize over and over again is staying plugged in. And by having a sales rep that travels perhaps to 10, 15 trade shows a year, is really active in the industry and staying up on things, is going to help benefit your business. And if you have a strong relationship with the various sales reps at different vendors, not only can you have a little bit of pull when it comes to price negotiation, but you really get tips throughout the year that are going to help you stay ahead of the curve.
Right, learn when new products are coming out and kind of stay ahead of everybody else if you have that relationship, so it's great.
Good. Tip number three, have a pricing strategy. So I like to preach on pricing here, so no surprise that this would be a tip that I added to a list. One of the big issues in this industry are people that really don't have a price strategy, companies that don't have a price strategy, and therefore leave themselves short on profit margin. So we have a lot of content on stallstv.com that has to do with how to come up with a price strategy, how to calculate costs, but the tip is make sure you have a price strategy.
Yep, and tip number four is niche and get rich. So this really is talking to the niche markets out there, such as cheer, maybe your niche is sports markets or schools, anything that you are doing. We have a segment on the morning show toward the beginning, which was Make It Your Market. So Courtney Kay talked a lot about different marketplaces, such as cheer. We did a lot of really
fun children's
ones.
Apparel, some municipalities, construction companies.
Mm-hmm. Mayors.
We never did mayors.
We never
that
did
was
mayors.
Maybe coming up in the as the November becomes a little bit closer, maybe we'll do some more political ones.
Yeah, so that was an inside joke. We were having a brainstorming session, planning the morning show and going through niche markets that Courtney Kay could do the Make It Your Market segment. And I'm not sure who came up with the concept, but somebody threw out. It was you? All right, you're taking claim to that one.
I mean, yeah, the mayor signs, they're all over the towns, they're in lawns, so you never know. Someone needs a shirt.
Somebody has to sell to mayor, so there's your tip of the day, I guess. All right, so on a serious note, tip number five is figure out what hat you wear best and wear it. So this isn't a fashion statement like Courtney Kay tries to bring to the morning show every week. You haven't reworn an article of clothing the whole time, right?
One time.
Yeah, so yeah. Fresh styles delivered to you every Monday morning.
Bonus points if you can find the outfit.
Yeah, but figure out what hat you wear best. And this is really an analogy to illustrate a business concept. As you're starting your business or your small company, there are a lot of tasks that you can get bogged down in. And often you're called on to do those tasks early on. But as you start to look at growing the business, figure out, you know, is sales where you want to be? Is marketing what you do best? Is it production work? And then fill in around you with the right type of hire. So understand what hat you wear best and make sure you add capability to the business, not just friends or somebody that you like. It's me again.
Yeah.
All right.
They go hand in hand.
All right. Another one I have is partner with local decorators that offer additional services. And this really just comes down to networking. This is tip number six, if you're keeping track. And once you know that hat you wear best, or once you understand what equipment you've really invested in your shop, this talks about filling in the gaps. You can be more of a complete shop, a one-stop shop, to offer different decoration services to your customer.
Right, if you don't have enough space in your shop to maybe house a screen printed machine, outsourcing that is a really good way to maximize your space and get the screen printed look.
Yeah, and I'd say a large percentage of the apparel marketplace, for those that are in it, outsource at least some piece of decoration. So those that are starting up often want to have it all in-house, but it's just not realistic. There can be a big learning curve, so make sure you partner well in your local neighborhood or even outside. I know people are always worried about, well, what if they take my customer? So make sure you build those trustworthy relationships or work with a vendor that sells just contract printing.
Yeah, we see that a lot at trade shows too. A lot of people network together that are in the different areas, and that's a great thing to do at trade shows while you're there in classes and attending, not only looking at vendors, but finding people to partner with.
Okay.
All right, so we're on number seven. So the seventh tip is do something unexpected for your customer. Delight them. Just go out of your way to make your customer feel special. This was, I think, Josh, the idea of a free prize in the box type thing where you're giving something to your customer, whether it's something free for a large order, just something they weren't expecting that makes them feel really special. I know a lot of businesses that even do follow-up strategies where they'll maybe show up the day after a large event, if they're doing promotional products, and show up with maybe a cup of coffee or something where they're reaching out to making sure that the person they're selling to just has a little bit extra something that's a little bit special to them.
Yeah, be memorable. I mean, one of the examples that I've seen this work before is when you're actually selling to a customer, and you always see it in like customer relationship management softwares where there's a field for like birth date on the contact, yeah. But it's there for a reason, being able to reach out to your customer, that valued customer, perhaps on a special occasion, whether it's their 1-year anniversary of buying from you or something that's special to them, like a birthday, and doing something sort of outside of the box or outside of the norm to delight them.
Yeah, it's a great idea.
So number eight is planning your day, and this is a big one for me. I walk into work and the first thing I do is make a list, and I think lists in general are a great way to maximize your efficiency. So if you kind of have an idea of what you're doing that day, what you need decorated, who you need to contact, it's going to make your work day just so much easier and just flow a lot better.
Do you operate off a list a lot?
I do, yeah, every day.
Yeah? Yeah. So I do as well. I don't find myself sticking to the list, so maybe I need to do a little better job of planning my day, but I'm easily sidetracked because I'm always trying to think of something different. But Planning a day is definitely a key. That's something I know I need to work on.
Right, and emails are a big part of the decorated apparel industry and really any office-like job. So not letting your emails kind of take over your work day and having a plan where you maybe set aside an hour or so for emails is also a good thing to do.
Yeah, and sort of in the vein of planning your day, I have here on tip number 9 is planning your throughput and maximizing this. And this really just speaks to understanding the capability that you have in your shop or how many pieces you can produce in your shop and working to make sure that you can make the maximum amount of profit on those pieces that you have the capability to produce. So everybody knows if you have a heat press, there's only so many garments that you can feed through that heat press over the course of a day, even with being the fastest, most efficient operator. So just making sure you drive profitability into everything that rolls through your equipment, especially if you're at full capacity.
Right, absolutely. So number 10 is going to be wear your best work, not your mistakes. So making sure the garments you wear out are the ones that are the best products that you're able to produce, so that you're always selling your business and showing your capabilities. We often hear a lot of decorators say, well, what's funny at trade shows, everybody shows up in their best work. I mean, we often see decorators there with as many blinged out products or just their high-end, whatever they've done that's the most unique, that's embroidered or heat printed, that's what they wear to the shows. But when you're out day-to-day, maybe traveling to the grocery store where all your local customers could be, that's where they're more or less, I messed up that shirt, I'll wear it, I'll give it to my kids to wear it. But you should always be, especially in your local area, marketing your business and showing the product and the offering that you can deliver.
Yeah, I would be curious to understand how many people actually wear their work, because that's the fundamental philosophy, is that making sure you're walking around with branded apparel. That's step one, and once you're doing that, making sure it's the best possible work that showcases your business and capabilities well.
Right, because every person you meet and every interaction you have is an opportunity to market yourself.
Good. Okay. Point number 11, pay yourself. You're in this business probably to make money. You're paying your employees. The business does deliver profit, but if you ever want to grow and replace yourself and really carry what you're doing in the business, you need to make sure you're incorporating that cost and paying yourself. So see this all the time where apparel decorators are not paying themselves for the particular part of the process that they're contributing to, because they own the business. So making sure you incorporate an hourly rate for the time that you're weeding or heat printing or screen printing or embroidering or sublimating or any of that stuff, right, that you do in the business. Pay yourself. It's important, and it will help you be able to replace yourself and take the business really to a scalable level.
All right, and so tip 12, we actually have a video to accompany this. It's creating a blueprint to maximize your workflow, and maximizing your workflow, that kind of says it all. So I'm going to throw it to this clip of Bob and Courtney.
We're excited to have Bob. We brought him on today for kind of our logistics guy. We always say he's the one that puts everything together and makes it make sense in workflow. And so one question we always get in the Stahls TV Morning Show from a lot of our viewers, as well as at stahlstv.com, is how do I set up my shop for successful printing? And it's kind of a loaded question.
It is.
But we're going to talk a lot today about proper layout for your shop, so how to get the most out of your equipment just by getting the right workflow for both you and your workers to kind of work with all of your equipment. And then we're also going to talk a lot about accessories, so you'll notice we have a lot of stuff laid out here. So just different common accessories and how to set up your shop for success and successful printing. So Bob, I think before we start to talk about layout, let's talk about equipment. So if we're talking to people that are starting up and just starting to lay out their shop, what are some recommendations for equipment you could give them?
Well, you have to start with a heat press. I mean, everything we do here at Stahls revolves around that heat press. That is our core, that's our hub of our business, is the heat press. You can't put on a transfer without a heat press. So starting with the right heat press, the one that's going to make sense for you, size-wise, starting with size, people say, which size should I get? 16 by 20 is what we prefer to offer, have you guys start with as your initial press. It's going to cover any size design that you're going to be able to come across over your as your business grows. And you never want to shortchange yourself by not having the right size heat press. As you grow, yeah, you can maybe knock down to a 16 by 16 or even 15 by 15 for specific designs and save a little money, keep a little space as far as space constraints go. Speaking of space, which type of heat press? If you are in a real tight area, and we know a lot of you are, a lot of these layouts are going to be a modified garage or a spare bedroom or what used to be the sewing room or the office, or people set up shop just about anywhere they can. If you don't have a lot of space, you may consider a clamshell. An auto-open clam is a great way to go because it has a smaller footprint, doesn't take up a lot of extra space, where the Fusion, which is more of a swing press, is going to take up an additional space on that side. So take in consideration your space that you're working with. No matter what, a 16 by 20, good solid heat press is going to be the foundation of your business.
So Bob is, as you mentioned in the video, the expert at planning sort of shop space, and he's went in and consulted with a lot of decorators on just that topic as one of our equipment specialists, really. And you heard it coming through multiple times from him in that video, invest in a 16 by 20 press and you won't look back. Now, a heat press is a very small portion of the investment as you get started in this business or as you look to grow. It's a very low cost, comparatively speaking, to other decoration technologies or even other bills that you're going to have in the business. So tip number 13 is stay lean. And it says stay, so not just start lean, but stay lean. Overhead, when you're calculating costs, can be a big piece of the expense. So although many of us dream for the big, elaborate retail space and that sign that, you know, we feel like we've made it, from an apparel decoration standpoint, right, with the building and everything, being lean or just calculating your growth and making sure you can justify every single thing that goes into the business from an overhead standpoint is important. It's really going to give you the competitive edge and really just safety with your cash flow and making sure you're managing the financial aspect of the business that allows you profit and success, which is the ultimate goal.
Yeah, definitely staying lean as far as what you're investing in, as well as equipment and all of that as well, not getting a little bit too far in over your head for that.
Okay, and then tip number 14 is consider a loss leader as marketing expense. So this is one that came later to me really in my career in sales and how this worked, but I would get the question at trade shows, man, my competitor is offering polo shirts embroidered for $4.99, or they're offering the t-shirt for $1.50 or $1.99. How can I compete? And a lot of times when you go and you do some research on these actual companies, it's a marketing strategy. They don't really sell all of their products at that low of cost, but it's a marketing concept called establishing a loss leader. And basically, this is a customer acquisition cost for them. So they'll take an item, a t-shirt or a certain style, and they'll establish it at an extremely low price, perhaps one that is a break-even point for them or that they even lose money on. And they choose that as a way to acquire new customers so they can sell them everything else that they offer. And it's a good way to really gain customers without having to invest a lot in other marketing expense. So consider establishing a loss leader for your business as the way to get customers in the door and then sell them everything else you have.
Yeah, we see that a lot in the sports industry as far as little leagues and just team sports, because you're using that business to be able to meet maybe their parents or other people in the mm-hmm. industry. Maybe you're going to break even on the team uniforms, but you're going to make a ton of money on the fan wear and the fundraising aspect of it. And so we see it a lot specifically there.
You know, we had Doug Wilcoxon from Bowmark Sportswear in, and the videos are up on Stahls TV, of course, but he actually talked about that, said you're going to have to view the team segment really for the schools and the organized leagues as a place where you're not going to make a ton of profit, but you're going to make it on all the peripheral, the spirit jerseys, the fan wear, everything that goes along with it. Now, he said you can make high margins on travel ball,
right,
but your standard team business, sometimes there's a budget, so you have to take it sort of as a loss or a break even to make big margins on everything else.
Yep, and we're up to tip number 15. Which is respond rapidly. So going back to those emails, even though it's important to segment your day and choose a time for emails, it's also important to respond rapidly to those. I've heard a lot of people say that, well, so-and-so didn't get it back to me for 2 weeks and this person got back to me within the hour, so I'm gonna go with them because I know that they're A, responsible, and B, going to get my product to me probably with that consistency as well. So responding to emails quickly as well as complaints, callbacks, and sales calls are all very important to keep your customer knowing that they are important to you.
And as a buyer, I have this experience all the time. You probably do as well as a consumer when you're looking for whether it's a new vehicle, a washer, a dryer, anything that you purchase. Response is everything, and you're usually willing to pay a little more. So it also helps on price negotiation and loyalty as well by being a responsive company.
Yeah, those are good points. All right, tip number 16, and I'm going to go with schedule time to think and manage an active business model. So this goes along with really planning your day. I shared a tip, I think last week on our Facebook page for Stahls, but just being able to really plan your day for active business planning and also creativity. You know, you get caught up so much in the emails and the production and everything else, so you don't step back and take time to think, how can I grow my business? What new market should I be looking at? What new design should I be thinking about? What's really new in the industry?
Right, and it's your business as it's your responsibility as a business owner to be up to date with what's new, what's going on. So always learning is definitely really important for that.
So we'll shameless plug Stahls TV here, stahlstv.com.
And shamelessly roll over to tip 17 and keeping up with trends. We're gonna roll some footage from a previous episode, episode number 43, that talks exactly about that.
I spent the last week at dance practice and a dance recital.
Sounds fun.
Yeah, I mean, literally five nights, all right, last week. I couldn't wait for Sunday to come. I had to record all the basketball games, watch them when I get home at, 10 o'clock at night, because these things go all night.
Right.
But anyways, you sort of sit there, and of course you're watching the dances, but you watch sort of the style and the fashion that the dancers are wearing, from little kids all the way down from, like, toddlers up through the juniors market and even the dance teachers, and you're seeing a lot of the flowy tanks and this sort of style and off the shoulder into the dance market. So fashion forward apparel is a great way to jump in and source some blanks for those styles.
Absolutely. So Josh does not wear the fashion hat here at the Stahls TV Morning Show, since he seems to have the same shirt on. You didn't follow the same rule, no repeat shirts throughout the 50 episodes.
No, I'm a big fan of, if you find something that works, you just go with it. Something duplicatable, replicatable, it works. You just go with it. Why stop? Why change? Too much risk in that. So anyways, tip number 18, thanks for that, by the way, is manage employees with measurable results at each step of the process. And that's a mouthful. And basically what this means is structuring measurements that really help to judge or measure employees. For instance, if you have a heat press operator, since we talk a lot about heat printing, finding out if there's a measurable result at the end of their day that you can consider it a success or a failure, or basically rate the quality of their day or the quality of the action that they are completing. And so for a heat press operator, it may look like number of pieces, but it also may look like a quality ratio, like 100% quality versus having garments that are ruined. So make sure that you structure results that can be measured for every function, every job that's being completed in your business, especially when you go to hire employees. And sort of along with that, I have here at tip number 19 is structuring a compensation plan that helps to meet your business objectives. So I'm a big proponent of creating the business plan, maintaining an active business plan every year. Once you create that business plan and you have your corporate goals or your company goals, is making sure that transcends all the way down through the organization to compensation, because you'll build an overall better company culture when what you're asking your employees to do, measuring them on, and paying them on is aligned to the company's mission and objectives.
Yeah, those are great ideas for definitely employee management and just running a successful business. Another one, as far as customers go, is number 20, diversify your customers. So there's a lot of risk in having one really large customer. While we love to have that customer, we know we make a lot of money off of that, and that's really our bread and butter. Being able to diversify, having new customers, new markets, and constantly going out and looking for new customers rather than feeling comfortable that you're able to make a nice profit because you have this large account, because there's a lot of risk in that if you lose that customer.
Yeah, I'd say land them. I mean, take the deal, don't turn it down.
Yeah.
But you want to make sure as quickly as possible, if you're a business that's heavily reliant on a particular account, you want to diversify, and you certainly want to lock up as much as possible into a contract for that
Definitely.
Business so you can plan the future. And along with that, sort of as you're locking up and we start to talk about contracts and just protecting the business, tip number 21 I have is protect your intellectual property. So what this speaks to is really, in a hiring standpoint, we've talked a little bit about that, as you bring employees on, perhaps establishing something like a non-disclosure agreement, or when you're looking for partners in the business, establishing something like that that can be signed to help protect any potential trade secrets or special processes that you have in the business that you wouldn't want to go out of your shop to competitors, even if it's a creative advantage or something that you have. Also making sure that if you have something like a business name that's catchy or a product, is getting proper trademarks and patents. Now, of course, everybody has the next million-dollar idea. You don't want to go crazy with investing buku bucks in patents and trademarks up front. But once you're confident that you really have something, make sure to protect it.
Agreed. So our next tip is about high temperatures and keeping them low, aka high temps, drop them down. There's a video about this that I would like to show you guys.
We had an absolute blast at STI. I'm sorry you couldn't be there.
Yeah, I'm sad I missed it, but I know you guys had a lot of fun at the show. Obviously, it looks like it was a great time. We always love seeing the heat printing brothers, or you guys perform songs at the show. So this one was a little bit different. It was actually a new song. We were excited to share it with all of our viewers here. What was your idea? Why'd you create this song?
Well, the inspiration, and just so you know, most of these get created when I travel on a trip, usually a business trip. I'm sitting in the hotel room and I'm like, man, we need another song for this year. And our chief marketing officer sort of pushes us. What's next? But anyways, the theme for this one was, of course, high temps, drop them down. And actually the inspiration came from a blog post on Ted Stahl's blog, where he said something to the effect of, the heat transfer market is so hot, but it's time to cool it down. And of course, it's a creative way to say that we're pressing stuff way too hot nowadays, overall in the heat printing world, and it's causing a lot of real challenges for decorators. So we wanted to drive that point home that if your temp's high, you need to find products and solutions that will allow you to drop it to do a lot of these heat-sensitive fabrics.
Right. So with the heat-sensitive fabrics, is that what we're starting to see a lot more of the wearable trends moving toward? Is that what you were seeing at the show as well?
Yeah. I mean, it's across the board. So those of you that are in business decorating know that customers want, number one, they want performance wear.
Right.
And so, of course, that's no longer a trend. It's a mainstay. It's really just what's the latest style of performance wear that's the trend. But performance fabrics are heat sensitive, so that's a key category. And then it's even bigger than that. It's venturing into cotton style t-shirts now, whether it's a shirt that feels like cotton but it's really made of polyester performance fabric, or it could be that there's polyester or rayon content or bamboo content even into the construction of a fabric that now makes it heat sensitive in just a t-shirt.
So garments are coming becoming a little bit more difficult to decorate. So having more materials out in the marketplace now that you can drop the temperature, such as a lot of the screen printed transfers and a few CAD cut materials from Stahls, are going more toward trending garments. So we are giving you the ability to take those high temperatures and drop them down.
Yeah, it's definitely something we see across performance wear, tri-blends, and a lot of the fabrics today. Especially the ones that are going to command a higher price. And so my strategy for number 23 is to present good, better, best strategies. Whether you do that in your garment selection, so choosing a regular 100% cotton t-shirt for your good, having maybe 100% polyester for your best, and then maybe more of a unique heather garment that's better, that's in a performance way. But you can kind of get unique with that. Also in your decoration, good, better, best, offering screen print finishes versus glitter. A lot of people even offer this same type of philosophy with packaging. So just making it simple for your customers to choose one of these three options. And usually you'll find that a lot of people go towards the best. They want that higher end option once they see them laid out as far as what they can have. We have a video that we had shared during one of the morning shows. We talked a lot about material content and fabric and how you can select good, better, best, even in garment selection. So we'll showcase that now to you guys.
Where we want to go with today's episode, decorators accommodating different fabrics. Like, one of the trends I know is decorating performance wear. We feature that plenty.
Right.
Stretch fabrics fall into that, even into the cheer market. But when we look at the broader market, t-shirt is still the number one selling item.
It is, and the t-shirt really is difficult to decorate today because it's not the traditional 100% cotton, easy to use. There's different weights, there's different fabric content. So now we have 100% poly, we have tri-blends, we have 50-50, 60-40. I mean, it's hard to really guarantee that every t-shirt is going to apply the exact same way through every print application.
Right, so there's different considerations as you look at the t-shirt market. And just as a quick reference, I want to pull up this piece that we've pulled down from Sanmar U, and they do a great sort of guide basic t-shirt guide going through their different styles. So we're going to talk through this, but most of this content's available from Sanmar U. You can download this guide where we go from the good, better, best philosophy as far as your basic t-shirt. So let's start with, on the far end of the spectrum, the open-ended cotton. So when we talk about open-ended cotton, we're typically talking about a shirt that's a value cotton. It can be different weights. So before we go too deep, let me just talk briefly about weight of fabric. So how do they determine the weight of a t-shirt fabric?
For the weight of the t-shirt fabric, it's actually the thickness of the material. So they would weigh the specific fabric content to know, no matter how it's constructed, it makes that same ounce. So if you see something like a 4.3 ounce versus a 6.8 ounce, there's going to be a difference in the thickness there.
Yeah, so you really get your guide on it when you're looking at a print piece by how many ounces. And so they'll take the square yard of the fabric and they'll measure the ounces. So basically, you know, we can categorize them as lightweight, midweight, heavyweight, but you're going to see it all the way from, you know, what, like a 2.7 ounce up to maybe like a 6 ounce.
Right.
That can be in a t-shirt construction. So as you're looking at a website or a print piece, there's definitely decoration considerations that you have to take into account when you're talking about different weights of t-shirts.
So as you can see in that video, we talked, that whole episode was really about fabric content. And by investing some of your time in learning about this, you'll be able to really understand what good, better, and best is. Not only for your personal knowledge, but you can relay that in a way that benefits your end customer as far as a lighter weight fabric, a heavier fabric. Often, you don't have to have an increased cost in the best category. It's just a perception of the customer being able to highlight that through your sales strategy. So I love those tips we give.
I do too. So tip number 24 is being professional. So being professional can mean a lot of things, but what I like to think about is branding. So I'm all about branding, creating a logo that looks professional, looking like your best self in order to be your best self. So if your website looks professional, you create a letterhead for your emails, you will give the perception of being someone who's maybe really successful who is just starting out.
Act as if.
Act as if, yeah.
Right? It's a good philosophy.
Don't they say fake it till you make it?
Fake it till you make it, exactly. I
any
love
of
all
those of work. Sounds like great t-shirts. You guys should make them. All right, Courtney, I think you got the next one. This is specially designed for you.
I feel like you guys set me up for this one. So tip number 25 is measure twice, press once, and then automate it. So this works a lot with alignment. Obviously not overdoing it as far as how many times you think about whether or not it's straight, but really just measuring twice, making sure you have it accurate, and then if you have the ability to add a tool, maybe an alignment, like a laser alignment tool that automates it, so every time you load that shirt on, it's straight every time. Like my shirts always are straight every time.
It doesn't say measure twice, show somebody in the room, put it back on, measure again, show somebody in the room. That's what we see in here. You guys know who you are when you're holding it up for your wife, husband, or somebody else that's in the business and saying, is this straight? Measure twice, press once, and automate it. It makes sense, and it'll help you really get maximum throughput at your heat press machine. The next thing we have is manage freight expense. We're going to break after this one. We're sort of just over halftime for some questions, but I'll share this tip first, is manage freight expense. So it's sort of one of those hidden costs, sort of like overhead or not paying yourself, that impacts the business, that can negatively impact profits. So making sure that when you're looking for blank apparel vendors or when you're looking to order heat transfer films or transfers, whatever it might be, finding a way, even in the quoting phase, to quote your turn times in a way that you can group orders and manage freight expense. If you can get it locally or delivered for free, especially on the blank apparel, go for it. But at least grouping orders and setting up a turn time to where you can do that is going to help make you a lot more money in the long haul by reducing cost. All right. So I understand there's some questions coming in, Joe. So Joe doesn't get to be on the camera all the time. Do we have a shot locked in for you today?
No. He sets the shots up.
No, he sets the shots up. So he never gets to be on camera. And if we tried to trick him, he'd move it back around quickly. But what are our questions, Joe?
Okay. So our first question is from Bernice. And she's asking, you know, she's just getting started and she's wondering, how does she price items when people just want a small quantity? For example, they just want one or maybe three shirts.
So the pricing strategy can be a whole episode for sure, Bernice, and we definitely have some episodes on like that. Just as a general tip, definitely on the one to three piece quantity, All the time that you use in artwork and sort of loading the material, all the tasks that really you only have to do once, regardless of whether you're producing one or 1,000, you're going to have to incorporate as cost in those low quantities. So making sure that you allow enough profit in those 1 to 3 pieces. So there's a lot of methods for pricing. I prefer a profit per piece method, and it's well outlined in different morning shows. I don't have the episode here, but we definitely have, if you search under stallstv.com, pricing strategy in the search bar, you'll come up with a full episode that will walk you through how to set that up.
Kat asks, regarding the contract and protecting intellectual property, would you have a sample form that they could begin with in order to use the that one, as you described earlier?
Easiest way to answer that is we don't, but we will. Okay, so there's we don't have that, but because the question was posed, what we'll do, similar to what we did in the fundraising episode, we'll make sure we put some templates together, or basic start together, that you can download under the resources tab. That one may take us a couple weeks, but we'll work on it for you.
We've also had several people ask if your list of tips from today's show will be available following this show.
You're gonna blog about that, right?
Yeah, I can blog about this.
So talk about the Stahls TV blog. That puts us right into that.
So the Stahls TV blog is delivered to you every Monday, Tuesday, and Thursday. We've been doing a lot of really fun tips on Mondays. Tuesdays have been Tip Tuesdays, so please feel free to ask me any questions that you want, if there are any specific tips that you would like to see. And then Thursdays have been Project Press It. So Project Press It is a weekly video series that shows t-shirt inspiration for the average decorator. And the looks are not average. They're really innovative looks and designs, and using a lot of new materials and different print areas. I mean, it's really neat to watch.
Yeah, so the blog, anytime we get a question like that where we can share content, the blog is a separate subscription. If you go click on the blog part of the top navigation, you'll be able to subscribe, and you can have this content hit your inbox multiple times a week. All right, Joe, what else we got?
The final piece is just a comment from Gretchen. She says, go Courtney, but it's for Courtney S. She says they sell quite a bit to political candidates from all different offices, including those of the mayor.
Fantastic. So we should probably
bring
in the future
mayors,
do
yeah.
Make it your market, mayors. It'll help viewers just like them.
Good. All right, what do we have? We're on tip number 27. We'll stop at the end, so feel free to keep the questions rolling in. What do we have for tip 27?
27 is actually my favorite number, so I'm going to take this one, which is be creative with production in mind. So when I think of production, I think immediately of weeding. Weeding is pretty time consuming, or can be, with the right or the wrong design. So keeping production easy by getting maybe an easy weeding table to make weeding faster, up to 80%. Also shameless plug.
Wow. I don't know if that was shameless or not.
No. And then being creative, maybe by using graphics that are designed for your either vinyl cutter or print cut machine. So Great Dean Graphics, Courtney actually did a video on their artwork and how you can have the easiest artwork for production.
So many plugs, you'll need a power strip.
Yes. I just like sharing our content and our sister companies.
Yeah, no, it's good. It's all stuff that's going to help you. But I think another thing I'll add there is sometimes you can be too creative, right? Creativity is one of the ways you separate yourself and win business and protect pricing and generate word of mouth. But I've been there personally where I've went too far out of the box on a job. And then you actually get the order after producing one piece, and you wish you never had the order because you went too far out of the box. And making sure you keep production in mind is very good.
Yeah, it's a great idea. All right, number 28, I'm going to go back to sales, but really document when and why you lose and win sales. So this really goes to understanding what you did to be so successful to win that job. Did you go the extra step? Did you do something unique to make that customer feel special that caused you to win that? If so, how do you replicate that so you can have additional successes like that? Also, when you lose a job, why did you lose it? Did you not follow up appropriately? Was the timeline off? Was the pricing wrong? Understand what you did there to lose it so you can correct it for the future orders.
Yep, and as a follow-up tip to that, managing a sales pipeline will give you the sort of the framework for documenting when you lose and why you lose, because it's the last step in the sales process, really. closed won, closed lost. Every sale reaches that point. But it starts somewhere else, and really it could start at pre-qualification or quoting or sample info sent. So usually a business will define sales stages that really should align to customer buying stages is a better way to put it. So how do your customers buy? What needs to happen before they reach that closed won or closed lost status, and making sure you group customers that you're working at various stages in the pipeline so you can schedule follow-up and really not lose sight of a potential deal that could make you money.
Right. And you can't really understand pipeline or sales or where your customers are in the stages without understanding your customer information. And so we're on number 30 here. So it's managing your customer information and using a software to do that and to automate it. So I know a lot of decorators keep their paper list of their top customers with phone numbers. Always having it in a digital form using a software that can maybe automate the information to pull email list or different campaigns for you to be able to follow up effectively with certain customers, or even just having a simple Excel list so everything's digital where you can see all of the information and sort it so you know what customers are what.
Yeah.
Right? And that's I think that's really helpful too if you're doing business on maybe multiple areas. So if you're at home working, or if you have a workshop working, if you have employees, just being able to share that information without having to copy and paste your papers is definitely important. Josh, would you like to talk?
Yeah, I would like to talk.
Did you have something you want to share?
Yes. So a couple of softwares that you may want to look at. Salesforce is a good one that I've always liked. There's Microsoft CRM that can be a good option. I haven't done much research on it, but I received a notification that HubSpot perhaps just came out with a free one. I'm not sure if there's any strings attached, but there are plenty of different solutions out there for really customer relationship and managing pipeline, customer contact, et cetera. All right, tip number 31 is pick up the phone. Don't be afraid of that thing. The phone is still an indispensable tool to a sales organization and a business that's trying to grow. A lot of people are afraid of picking up the phone, and millennials, which I'm on the top side of that generation, although I don't align with necessarily the stereotypes of millennials, sometimes only pick up the phone to type into it, right? To text. And that's not a bad way to break through, but making a phone call sometimes can separate your business from the competitors. The fact that you're willing to call and try to drum up a sales opportunity or follow up on a sales opportunity or send a thank you is a great way to separate yourself.
Right, and sales calls are always a part of marketing as well, and just how you connect with customers and how you contact them. So tip number 32 is to create a marketing plan. Always have your tools available to be able to sell to your customers. So creating them yearly or quarterly, that really helps if you follow or you reach a lot of markets to be able to have your promotions and your specials in place. We come up to October where it's Halloween. Well, people may have been looking for Halloween stuff in September. So if you don't promote that until the week before Halloween, you may be too far gone that you need to be a little bit more ahead of the game. So having that marketing plan in place for all of your different avenues, whether it's emails or different promotions or flyers or things that your salespeople need to go out as far as samples, having that available really helps. And we have an ebook available under the resource section at stallstv.com that was created by Stahls. It just helps you really create a marketing plan for your apparel business.
Right, and part of that marketing plan is the email marketing, which I think is very important. So having an email marketing plan can grow your profits by sending these emails when they're relevant. So you say October, send maybe fall themed, and creating a strategy with like a calendar in mind. So there are a few places or a few websites you can use to email market, which is MailChimp, GetResponse, and Constant Contact. And all of those, you just want to make sure when you're talking to your customers, if they ever have to fill out a form, you get their email address just to stay in touch.
Yeah, and they opt in, typically, so they give you the permission to communicate, and email is still one of the best responses we get in sort of the business-to-business environment. So I think it would work for apparel decorators as well that sell a lot of business-to-business often.
Right, and selling them or sending them at least twice a month, I think, is a minimum.
Absolutely.
So the next tip, number 34, is increasing word of mouth by building relationships on social media. And so the first morning show I was on was actually about Instagram. Courtney and I talked a lot about how to grow your business using social media, using hashtags, just interacting with your customers. So the use of all of these social media places where it's not direct contact with these people that you're trying to, you know, sell to, you're still getting your ideas out there, you're getting your promotions out there, any sort of specials that you would be offering. So definitely just using social media and being able to have people like and share a post is just really nice to do.
And social media in general really helps to expand you past even your local market. If you're looking to sell nationally or into a larger customer base, you really can grow a lot more with social media and different internet searches and things like we'll talk about a little bit later. So the next tip I wanted to share, number 35, is to build out your product offering slow and steady. So my mom used to always say, slow and steady wins the race. So rather than selling a ton of products, you're really overdoing your product offering and the equipment that you've invested in. Either way, understanding your business model, not overspending and purchasing a direct-to-garment printer and a screen printing press and a heat press and embroidery machine, and really having too much overhead, that follows a lot of the staying lean that we talked about earlier. But even your product offering, if you're trying to offer everything, I always say do a few things really well and then start to expand from there and really just understand what your customers are looking for before you try to do it all.
Yeah, try it first, right? That's the point is I've been guilty of this in the past where I think I have that multi-million dollar idea and we're going to launch this thing nationally or worldwide. Well, how about picking a state or picking a small group of customers and trying it first and getting some market feedback? So that sort of methodical approach to new products or to something, a new offering, is a great way so you don't get yourself in over your head quickly.
Yep. All right, so number 36 is it's all about presentation. And so you have, say, a brand new idea, a brand new item, maybe something really creative that you want to show off. So showing off these samples virtually, I think, is a really not only easy way to get your ideas out there, but to also reduce your costs. So low cost to no cost, showing virtual samples. And one of the ways you can do that is through CADWorks Live. So we have a few videos on our website talking about creating virtual samples on CADWorks Live. I know we're, I don't know if the videos are up yet, but we're doing a few on Transfer Express's Easy View as well. So just maybe uploading the shirt that you would like to sell on there, putting your design on there in a virtual sample, and then sharing that out as opposed to getting the materials in, printing it, and then having a reduced profit margin on the one piece, whereas you can sell it first and then buy everything together, which will reduce cost.
Yeah, because customers never want to change the design, right?
No, so never.
Yeah.
Virtual keeps you open as well, so they're not asking for another expensive sample and you got to order another one. And just it allows you to sort of create ideas with customers, collaborate across something, and make quick and easy changes. All right, the next one I have on the list, number 37, is make customers your sales team. Ask for referrals. So I said earlier that closed won, closed lost is sort of the stop of the sales process, but there's another step that goes into the closed won in most training programs, and that is asking for a referral. So after you win the business and the customer's at an all-time high, you're moving forward, perhaps even after you deliver the package, at some point in the process, make it a practice to ask for a referral. Do you know anybody else that could benefit from decorated shirts like this? If you're selling to a team or a league, are you networked with any other leagues or perhaps participate in tournaments where people could benefit from these services? So making a practice to ask for referrals and really making yourself shareable. So you spoke to the social media aspect, but encouraging customers to share. So maybe giving them a coupon code or enter for a free giveaway. I went and picked out a slab of granite. I think it was last week. Yeah, it's crazy. Crazy experience, but we won't go into that. So I went and picked up a slab of granite. What? Anyways.
Good.
We don't practice these stories. They just come up in my head. So anyways, we're picking out a slab of granite and at this place, and we picked it out, and we're getting ready to leave. And a great sales experience, but one of the last things they asked me to do is say, hey, if you share a photo of the slab of granite or your experience here as you're picking it out on our Facebook page, you know, just tag our Facebook page in it, you'll be entered to win a $100 giveaway, and we do it once a month. That's really inexpensive promotion. It's going to cost them $1,200 a year, and you know all the referrals they're getting just by the fact that we're endorsing them, that we went and shopped there? and multiply that by all of them that they sell, it's a viable strategy.
Yeah, definitely for t-shirts and apparel as well, because so many people wear their items out to different events, and so it's a great way to showcase what you can do for events or groups or even custom t-shirts.
All right. I feel like you didn't like my story, but we'll move on.
I'll ask you later about it. I was surprised you were in a home improvement store.
All right. She's on a roll.
This is going to be my year. All right, tip number 38 is consider going mobile, so print and sell where people are. I am truly impressed with how many customers today, at every trade show I go to, it seems like more people are printing at events, whether they have trailers or they just set up an event. The heat press really leverages or gives you the ability to leverage that a lot and being able to print. We talk about it and ways to do it a lot in the morning show, but you should be considering going to these events and at least selling to them. But if you can print there, it helps to maximize your profit as well.
Yeah, the impulse buy.
Yeah.
Right? You know, you're willing to pay more for, you know, a shirt at the event. So what's the last shirt you bought at an event?
I bought a shirt at the U.S. Open. So we were just sharing some things about the U.S. Open on last week's episode. So that was the last one I bought.
Yeah. So, and I'm sure you paid a pretty penny, yes, you know, for the shirt there versus the potential for getting it online and having it relate to the event.
Right.
You know, the experience to commemorate it can generate that extra profit. All right, tip number 39, who got it?
That's me. All right, upsell and package products for increased profit. So upselling and packaging is something I talk about often. I think it's one of the easiest ways to sell more products and make more profits is just to sell more to every customer. So rather than selling a t-shirt, you should be selling a jacket and a pair of sweatpants with it. And if you're selling t-shirts in the spring to construction companies, you should be going back to them in the fall and asking if they need outerwear. And so just a lot of that ability to upsell and package and sell more to every customer. And we did a, as fall starting to come up, we did a morning show on outerwear, which is something that packages really well in different groups. And so we want to share some tips about choosing outerwear and stuff for that now.
Why is outerwear such a big profit potential for a decorating business?
You know, I think when we think of outerwear, we're automatically thinking about just heavy 3-in-1 jackets or insulated jackets, but the outerwear category is so large with performance wear, quarter zips, hoodies. And I can rattle names off as far as blazers, cardigans, anything really that goes on over a jacket or over a t-shirt or something can be considered outerwear. So the opportunity is huge. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of high margins because a jacket, which now may have sold for, let's say, $80, allows you to have a profit potential usually of $40 or $50 per jacket versus a t-shirt where you might only be making $5 or $10. So there's a huge need for decorators to want to print these and bring them into their product line because it's a huge profit margin.
Okay, so same amount of work to decorate a t-shirt as it is to decorate a jacket,
right,
we're saying, or decorate outerwear, but you can make a lot more money off of it.
All right, we were just debating on whether we were going to cut it off early and share the last 10 tips on the blog or keep going, and I think we're going to keep powering through. So if you need to log out because we're running a little bit over our predicted time, we'll make sure we share these last 10 tips on the blog, but if you want the commentary, we're going to keep rolling. So tip number 40 is find a blank apparel supplier that ships same day. The order is placed, and also one that's within a one-day transit. Now, that's a long point to basically say you want to source smartly for your blank apparel. Make sure that you have that core supplier that has a wide range of products so you can group orders together to manage your freight expense and ultimately get product quickly to offer quicker turn times. That relationship with sort of the all-purpose supplier, they may not have your fashion-forward sort of niche market stuff, but they handle the bulk of what you order.
Yeah, and the fast turn time is definitely helpful if you need to get something quick, you have a rush order or a customer like that, that really helps to save on freight expense there. All right, so the next one I have is to under-promise and over-deliver. So really just meet expectations from your customers. If you don't think you can deliver on something, don't tell them you can and then fall short, whether it's a deadline or a product offering. And then whenever you do promise to do something, make sure you follow through so you're meeting those expectations every time and giving them a quality result.
Yeah, it's tough to say no, but often it's the best answer to maintain your integrity as a business and get the next one and customer loyalty. So if you can't do it, make sure you under-promise or quote an accurate turn time. Missed or late orders are a very customer-damaging event.
Right, and if you say it's going to take 3 weeks and it takes two, they'll just be that much more excited. So tip number 42 is to offer extra incentives. So those loyal customers that we were talking about earlier, the people who you want to keep as your core, considering their customer loyalty is definitely something that you want to consider. So maybe offering loyalty discounts, maybe for their one-year anniversary buying from you, you can send them some sort of maybe a sample of a new product or a, you know, coupon of some sort. But sweetening the pot, as they say, is a good way to just make your customers feel like they're special, and giving discounts for loyalty is one of those ways.
Yeah, don't take them for granted, really.
No.
You know, that it's not that they're out shopping, but you keep them closer and away from shopping by extending some of those things to your loyal customers, that's for sure.
The 43rd tip is going to be know your customer or know your client, so understand who you're selling to and who you're marketing to. So you're not going to take the same packages and product offering to a construction company that you're going to take to the school's football team or to the cheerleading mm-hmm. squad. So as you're creating these niches and these markets like we talked about earlier, understand who you're selling to, what are they looking for, what do they need, create packages and samples that are going to specifically speak to them, and you'll be a lot more successful that way. Absolutely.
Oh, yeah.
All right. The 43rd is going to be network and use community events for marketing opportunities.
The 44th.
44th, what'd I say?
It's all right.
43rd again?
Can't remember. Okay. 44th.
It's long when you get this far in. So the 44th is going to be network and use community events. So we talked a little bit about this on the 5K episode, where you're going to events or you're going to community groups and really just being an active part of the community and being known as a local business. That sets you up to network with business owners to be able to get their business for their apparel, and also just getting to know other people within the local community so that you're actually the person they want to go to. They're not going to have to go to that online company because they have a local guy that they trust and they know and that they want to help.
Yeah, getting involved, right? Joining the Chamber of Commerce, just showing up and having conversations, you know, always be on your A game when you're out at these events, building relationships. That's going to help you grow the business astronomically.
Yeah, on the other side of that point, though, being visible and having an online market presence is also important. So having your company be able to be searchable, using key SEO words, a lot of text on your homepage to be able to be searchable, even just posting on Facebook will get your name and keywords out there as long as you're using them. So using well-established businesses such as Etsy and Amazon is a easier way to sell and market. So we have a clip for you guys to look at here.
But now with sites like you mentioned, the Etsy, Amazon, eBay, it's really given a lot of decorators a huge new avenue to sell in that's really easy to get into. Mm-hmm. It's really inexpensive, and basically anybody can get into it. So I guess we'll talk a little bit about why people are using it. So
sure.
Obviously those sites all have a really large, strong audience. So it takes away any of the decorators having to do a lot of selling themselves. I think that's probably one of the main reasons that decorators are getting into this. They're mm-hmm. seeing it as more of a an easy way to sell, kind of like the way websites, which we'll talk about here in a little bit, niche marketing. So we're able to take a hold of their target audience, especially if they're already reaching it. I think that's where Etsy got really as big as it is. If you're looking to reach that kind of craft market or maybe weddings or more custom t-shirts for women, Etsy's mm-hmm. kind of grown into this huge platform for crafty type sellers or people that are looking for that type of thing, and they're going there, they're looking for it. So if that's the customer base that you're looking to reach, those kind of sites really can benefit you. Obviously, one of the biggest advantages, especially if you're a new or a startup decorator, is they're already trusted. So everybody knows Amazon, everybody knows eBay, and now everybody really knows who Etsy is too mm-hmm. because it's so popular. So you don't have to go through the whole process of having to really make a name for yourself as much as you would if you were just starting up on an online platform. Yeah.
Courtney, does it seem whenever you do a morning show with Zach that for some reason you do most of the talking?
Yeah.
I've been feeling that way as well.
Yeah, you do a lot of the talking all the time.
I feel like you're in training from him, though, because he likes to sit there and he'll give you the yes. Okay. Mm-hmm. The absolutely. He's famous for that. We're going to share a little bit of that with you later, but tip number 46 is have a post-sale strategy for follow-up business. So when you win that business and you're starting to think of how do I make that a repeat customer, just having a strategy for that. Maybe it's a time sample after their first order or a timed offer or an incentive that goes in the box for them to order again. Making sure you consider how do I take this from a one-time buy to a long-term customer is going to be key. 47 is have an apparel branding strategy. So this is the last tip that I think I'm going to share to you ladies, bring it home, is really hang tags, labeling, packaging, etc. Just branding your apparel. This goes along with the fake it until you make it, but just faking it really well. Branding yourself and setting yourself up to be that established brand. Even if you've been in business for a long time, there's a way that you can separate yourself when you deliver a garment with a simple hang tag that brands the business, or perhaps a tagless label inside of the shirt or on the sleeve, or some way that people know that this was decorated by your shop. It can really elevate the image of the business.
All right, so tip 48, this is a quick one, just to make artwork investments that reduce costs and improve time. Going back to weeding, you just want to make sure that you're picking artwork that is easy to weed. So we have a video on Stahls TV if you're interested in watching it. It's art for vinyl cutting. So it talks again about Great Dean Graphics and just how having a subscription to that while you are paying money will save you money in the long run by reducing costs and time.
And purchasing artwork really that's production ready. So we see a lot of decorators that get tied up in taking a piece of artwork. Of course, it'd be great if your customers brought their artwork ready and it was perfect for your print process, but that's never going to happen. So if you can direct your customers by purchasing clip art and creating artwork that's designed so it's ready for screen printing, or it's designed to be ready for print and cut or vinyl cutting, it just helps to really make the production process a lot smoother.
Agreed.
All right, 49, so one left after this. It's become an expert in decoration. So this is something we really strive to do in educating at Stahls TV, but just understanding when to use each decoration method, what works best for every fabric, what works best for this garment, and really just being an expert to your customers, to where your customers are coming to you as an expert and they're looking to you for their decoration.
Tip number 50, watch the Stahls TV Morning Show. I mean, didn't you know that was going to be the last tip? We certainly appreciate your loyalty through now what's been 50 episodes. It's been a fun ride for us. And we're happy to say that we've been renewed for another season.
We have.
So we're going to be with you for at least another 50 episodes, hopefully many more. But we really value your feedback. We do read it after every session. And so we've done a little bit of a special survey with this 50th episode session, where we hope that you'll take some time, give us some written response feedback so we can improve the show and make sure it's the type of content that you like and that's benefiting your business. And then we also like to have a lot of fun. And something, I don't know who pointed out first, but it's evident that we say absolutely
at least
an
10
awful
times
lot.
An awful
lot.
Yeah, it's our Stahls TV catchphrase.
Yeah, absolutely. So we're going to leave this episode with a little fun clip that shows how much we use that actual phrase. And we'll see you next week on the Stahls TV Morning Show. Thanks for watching.
Thanks for watching.
Things that caught our attention as we were browsing through some of the industry sites that report news.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, they absolutely do. Absolutely.
You can do it with just a heat press.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely.
Absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right, absolutely. Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Right, absolutely.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Thanks for watching the Stahls TV Morning Show.